morning, everybody.
Morning.
And this morning, I got out of my closet, and Elizabeth looked at me, and you wear this shirt backward, right? And this is intended, because this takes one slide, and which is the main verse of the sermon today, which is, taste and see the Lord is good. And on the back is the teen's group, and I keep it on the front. And this, I think, I believe Vince designed this. And it's a very, actually, have the Chinese takeout. And so I have been going through this series with you, Awakening Our Senses. So the idea is that we, as God's people, not only have physical senses, but also spiritual senses. But oftentimes, our spiritual senses are dead, are not awakened. Only through Holy Spirit and through our own effort can we awaken the spiritual senses. So we have gone through a couple of senses already. So if you look at those five senses, we have gone through see, right? We have hear and touch. And so what's left are taste and smell. And today we're going to unpack the idea of taste God. And taste is something related with food, right? Everybody loves food. Who doesn't love food? Everybody loves food, right? But for the food we never tried before, we human beings oftentimes are very cautious. And if you look at babies, for the food they never tasted before, they don't want to try. And so I have a picture of a platter of the gourmet cheese, and next slide. And if you have never tried, some of those cheese are aged cheese, meaning they are kind of smelly and stuff. And are you willing to try it? How many of you are willing to try it? Okay, a few. Okay, great, brave souls, bless you. But a lot of you are not willing to try it, right? And we're not willing to taste the food we never tried before. And you are not alone. I was actually reading a blog of a 15-year-old, and she's like this. I'm 15 years old. I suffer from the fear of the taste of food. It's weird, I know, but it really is annoying. I feel so uncomfortable during events where the families gather and have big dinners. I just don't eat barely anything because I only eat a few different foods. Does anyone else suffer from this? Do you know how to stop it without professional help from doctors? Please, no website link, just simple answers. And so the blog stopped there, and there are a few answers as you come in. And the basic idea is there's really no simple answer to solve this phobia for new food. And this 15-year-old does need professional help to overcome that phobia. A simple answer won't help. But she was looking for a simple answer. Try new food is hard. And try taste God, who is invisible, is equally hard, if not more. I still remember the moment I gave my life to Jesus. I was scared. I was scared because I was committing my life to God, whom I cannot see. And here in Psalm 34, is an invitation from God to us. Taste and see that the Lord is good. God knows that we are scared. So He extends invitation to us. And fortunately for us, to overcome this phobia of tasting God, we don't need to see a medical doctor. But we do need the courage. And I'm a living proof that I did not see a medical doctor to really taste Jesus and taste the goodness of Jesus. And you can do the same if you know how. So that's the topic of today's message. Let's pray before we start. Father God, you are good. You are compassionate and gracious, rich in love, slow to anger. But Lord, we often do not know you enough to rely on you. Lord, give us courage to take upon your invitation. When we try to know you, show us your goodness. Let us see, let us taste that you are good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And recently I heard a shocking story over the radio. An emerging atheist band called Quiet Company gave their performance at the annual atheist conference. And isn't it funny that atheists need to have a conference? And they need a conference to reinforce their belief. There's no belief. Right? They need to have a conference and have speakers to talk about, okay, you need to believe in no belief. Right? And the next time when you in your school, there are some people say ridicule about your faith in Christianity, in Christ, you should tell them, dude, look at yourself. You are just trying to convince me to believe in what you believe, which is believe in nothing. Right? I mean, atheist is as much a faith as Christianity. It just takes the form of there's no absolute truth. But anyhow, this band called Quiet Company, the leading vocal and songwriter, to my dismay, actually was a worship leader in a Christian band. So he grew up in teens group, in college, leading worship. But he became an atheist. I was just very curious about this guy, right? So I started to read the lyrics of his songs. And in one of their songs, the lyrics goes like this. If Jesus Christ ever reached down and touched my life, he certainly left no sign to let me know he had. So this guy, he led worship. He goes through all the motions in high school, in college. Never ever felt Jesus' touch on his life. How sad. How sad this situation. The vision of this congregation is to develop Christ followers from the younger generation and to live out our faith in our daily lives. If by the time you graduate from high school, and you still have not experienced God and in your life and felt his touch in your life, then we failed as a congregation. We failed as a group to achieve our mission. Tasting God solidifies our faith in Christ. We have to taste God to make us a Christian. Otherwise, it's all superficial. Otherwise, it's all kind of intellectual knowledge. If you look at the faith, the giants in faith in Scripture, they all know God personally, not intellectually. They tasted God. And they saw that God is good. The first example is Jacob. So what does Jacob, the name of Jacob means?
Oh,
yeah,
you have to do the
right
thing,
like God thing,
so the
baby's gonna Yeah, grab. Jacob means grab. Yeah, grab. The Jacob likes to grab stuff. So much so that he cheated on his brother to get the firstborn right. He cheated on his father so that his father will bless him. He cheated on his uncle, Laban, so that he can have a lot of the herd. But he had a personal encounter the night before he went back to his homeland. He wrestled with the Lord personally and won. He had a permanent mark on his body, and God touched his hip, and Jacob was limping from that point on. Does that ever occur to you that God allows Jacob to win because God loves Jacob? Do you really think that Jacob can really overpower God? God took pleasure to let Jacob pin him down to the ground. You can wrestle with God. It is okay. You can just kind of fight against him, right? And you just back and forth argue. It's okay. But it's not okay to say, okay, God, you're up there, I'm down here. You don't really know me. And you don't know what I've been through. That's not our God. Our God, he descended from heaven to walk on the earth. He knows every pain we have been through. Our God died on our behalf so that we don't have to die. Right? You can wrestle with God, but God, our God, did not leave us the option to say, you are indifferent and leave me alone. So Jacob encountered God when he wrestled with God. He tasted and saw that the Lord was good. From that point on, Jacob was a new man. I don't know if you recall the scripture. The night he was wrestling with God, he sent all his children and the two wives ahead of him and just say, you go ahead and cross the river. And if my brother Esau saw you, and just keep going. He was a coward. What kind of guy let your children and your wife and they go before you, let the enemy hit them first? He was a coward. But after that encounter, he stopped the entire caravan. And he's like, okay, kids and wife, stay here. I'll go ahead. After that encounter with God, he was a changed man from a coward to an audacious leader. So he took up the risk himself. He's no longer cheating anymore. He's no longer like evading people. He's no longer trying to kind of win by his own intellectual power. Now he's a brave man. He faced his enemy, his brother Esau, who was trying to kill him. And by God's grace, and he actually was okay. But from that point on, you see Jacob become a new man. And actually, that very night, God wrestled with him, and God changed his name to Israel. He's no longer a cheater. He's no longer a grabber. He's somebody who wrestled with God, and God allowed him to win. So Jacob tasted God and saw it was good. The other person, Peter, in New Testament, he knew God personally. He tasted God. Do you know who else other than Jesus walked on water? That's Peter, right? Peter is the only human who walked on water other than Jesus. So that night, and Peter was on, and with other apostles on the boat, And then Jesus was walking on water. And the apostles were scared. And they cry out, it's a ghost. But Jesus said, fear not, it is I. And then Peter said, if it's really you, let me walk to you. And then Jesus said, okay, come. So Peter jumped out of the boat and started to walk on water. But then the wave started to become big, and he looked at the wave and moved his eyes away from Jesus and started to sink. And then Jesus reached out his hand and pulled him out of the wave and got onto the boat. Though short, Peter walked on water. Did he? Peter still made mistakes. Peter is the kind of guy, I love to have Peter, those kind of like friends like Peter. He just speak whatever on his mind. And he denied Jesus 3 times, right? Remember? And he made mistakes. God allow us to make mistakes. That is okay. And because he made those kind of 3 denials, and Jesus, after his resurrection, after he cooked the breakfast, the fish and the bread breakfast on the shore, he approached Peter, asking him, do you really love me? Also 3 times. Right? So the Peter denied Jesus 3 times. And Jesus asked him 3 times, do you really love me? It is okay for us to make mistakes. It is okay even for us to deny Jesus. But it's not okay to be indifferent toward Jesus. Jesus did not leave that option to us. He said, I am the bread of life. Whoever eats me will never be hungry. God extends the invitation to us. And he said, taste and see that I'm good. But still, some Christians, young and old alike, going through churches, Bible study, and all kinds of conferences without tasting God. Why? Why we live, go through all the motions without tasting God? Why? I would venture to say the reason being, we're not hungry enough. The platter I showed you, if I let everybody in this room starve for 30 days, and I tell you this is food, it will not hurt you. It will only satisfy you. I betcha nobody will say, okay, I'm not going to eat it. The reason we are afraid of tasting is that we're not hungry. The reason we don't taste God is because we think we have enough. Our life is okay without the Lord. But is it? So let's walk through our life path very quickly. My path. Some of them that I have not encountered. We try to do well in school. Not because I want to learn, but because it's a means to an end, going to a good college. And so sometimes to achieve this means, right, sometimes I cheated. And sometimes I just pull an all-nighter for the exam. Not to learn anything, just to remember something and to forget about it after the exam. Got over with. And after I going to college, I had my newfound freedom. I tried different things. alcohol, girlfriend, parties. In the same time, because of the, in every good college, you are surrounded by perfect A students, good looking, smart. And I don't even know that whether I belong there. And I stumble along, and by the time I graduate, the friends I made all scattered to different directions. Then I needed to find a job. When I landed a job, it's pressure, long hours, very long hours. And my colleagues were equally talented and have equally impressive credentials. And there are also colleagues who are trying to get ahead of you and piss you off. And at this time, you probably get married, I did. And only to discover the sweetheart you married is not sweet of marriage, not always. And we think things that are hurtful, and that they have pet peeves just to kind of irritate you. And the worst thing is that you have to live like 7 days a week. And then retirement. And then the inevitable death that will wipe away all the wealth and fame and reset everything. Is everything good? Is this kind of life good? Who thinks this kind of life is good? I don't think anybody will think this kind of life is good. This kind of life is dead. Without Christ, all we do is a spiral, quickly moving toward death. Let alone the daily struggle that we go through. And our life, in and by itself, dealt a really bad hand to everyone. And many people look at me and thinking that I'm accomplished, and went to good schools and a good family and a career. But you don't know the times I hated life. Life is a grueling game. I can tell you that without Christ, without purpose of blessing other people, in Christ's love and hope, life is a meaningless and hopeless drudgery. But Christ changed everything. This life is not only worth living, but worth joyful living. And I love every day that the Lord gave me. I think it's a gift from heaven, from the God. I love my family. I love the people around me in work. I love you guys. I even love the strangers I see in the street. And a lot of times, life pushes us without our permission to a very difficult situation. And at that time, we become hungry. During those times, we feel we're hungry, even though we're not willingly going to that situation. And it's at those junctures that we meet God. So thank God for those difficult situations. When David wrote this Psalm 34, he was in his run for life. Saul was trying to kill him. And he went into this foreign land, and the country called Gath, and the king of that land say, isn't he the song was about like Saul has slain thousands and David his tens of thousands? And so David was really scared because he was all by himself, and if other people were trying to kill him, he probably had very little likelihood to survive. So he pretended to be insane, let the drool kind of running down his beard. It was pretend to be insane. And in this dire situation, he cried out to God. He took refuge in the Lord. And then the king, Gath, and that time, king of God let him go. And the king David said, taste and see the Lord is good. I encountered Jesus when I was first in States, right? And at that time I felt my life hit a wall. And in that, I thank God for that difficult time, because it is because of that difficult time I tasted and see the Lord is good. And some of you may not be in a difficult situation right now. Our hearts are content with the things that we can see and use. We're okay. It's to those hearts that God's saying, taste and see I'm good. God is calling us to walk on water, to get out of our comfort zone, and to stretch our ability to the extent that we have to rely on God. Are you playing safe all the time? Taste to see the Lord is good. He's a calling to us to take a chance on God, to gamble on God. And sometimes our hearts also become callous, and we're hurt too much, so our hearts are closed. We don't want to try anything. It is to those hearts God is saying, taste and see that I'm good. Life sucks, many of you say, and you hate school, and life is hard. Many adults dread waking up in the morning going to work on Monday, and we celebrate this thing called the TGIF, right? And for the teens, you may be driven by your parents to do certain things. You may feel that you don't have anybody who understood you. You don't feel accepted by many. And God is saying to you, taste and see that I'm good. So let's suppose you're hungry enough, willingly or unwillingly, and you want to taste God.